Barbara is among the growing number of people that are being set free from the cycle of homelessness through the work of New Life Evangelistic Center. Be sure you stay tuned and see how your gift, your prayers, is making such a big difference not only in her life, but many others. I'm Larry Rice, and this is Here's Help. Barbara is among the growing number of people that never thought they'd end up homeless that found herself in the ranks of the homeless. It's called a cycle of homelessness, that you continue to try and try and try, but it's hard to get out of, isn't it, Barbara?
Yes, it's hard to find a job once they find out you've been without work a while. And if they do find out you're homeless, then they don't want to hire you.
Barbara, how is it helping you to break out of that cycle of homelessness by being at the New Life Evangelistic Center and being in the Transitional Housing Program?
Well, for one thing, I'm able to be clean, get a good night's sleep. Connie, the social worker, works with us. She brings us the papers that have jobs listings. She goes on the internet for us. She keeps a follow-up on us as to if we're right on target with what she wants us to do. And she just talks to us. You know, anything you have a problem with, she'll sit down and talk to you. And she just tries to help.
Connie's on the staff here at the New Life Evangelistic Center, social worker on staff, and that's helping you to break that cycle of homelessness.
Yes. She signed me up for some computer classes, too, so I could bone up on the typing stuff, too, and being able to put an application in online.
There are many like Barbara that are discovering a new beginning because of those of you that are sharing with the New Life Evangelistic Center. Let's go to Chris.
Hello, I'm Pastor Chris Rice here at the New Life Evangelistic Center. What's your name?
Mary Frances Hoppe.
Okay, and Mary, you've been here at NLEC for the past month. Tell us a little bit about your story and what brought you here and what it's like here for you at New Life Evangelistic Center.
Well, I never thought I would be homeless, but I did get in this situation. I was always a working girl, but the companies went bankrupt with the economy the way it is. I ended up without a home. I tried staying with family members, and that doesn't always work out, expectations there. So I found myself homeless, and when I called the other shelters, they just kept saying, nothing's available, and I would say, well, what am I supposed to do? And to them, once they said nothing's available, you're just not their problem anymore. Yeah. So New Life was what was left for me. And since I've been here, they've been very helpful, making sure that I'm fed and sheltered. I'm not out in the rain, or I'm not out in the streets. Anything can happen out there.
So as a woman going through this experience, has it taught you anything?
To always believe that God's taking care of you, and maybe you don't understand things, what's going on, but as long as you know that His love's there, you'll be fine.
Yeah. So this is your first time experiencing this. Has it been, have you felt like there's eyes watching you, you know, or that people are looking at you to either do harm or judge you? Have you felt judged? Have you felt, what are some of the things you feel?
I think my experience? Situation might be a little bit more unique, because when I'm out, I don't look homeless. I don't have the some of the stereotypical things, the backpack or whatever. Nobody could tell that I'm homeless, but I'd still just the same when that night comes. I had no place to go. But I see people staring and yelling and throwing things at homeless people, because they have no respect. They don't understand the world. They only see the negative part, and I think people maybe don't even want to try to understand. They're just afraid they're going to get it or something. I don't know.
Yeah. So, I mean, what would you say to someone who really has a hard time judging people who are homeless?
Try and realize that you may think you could never be that way, but you'd be surprised just throughout history, people who have been wealthy at one time can very easily end up right on the street, just like anybody else. So you think that could never happen to you, but you really don't know. So just there's no reason to be so judgmental that we're all in the same boat together.
As you're experiencing this and you're seeing what people are going through, what are some of the other needs that that are very visible in St. Louis for the homeless? What are some things that people that are not provided?
Financial assistance. I mean, there's a lot of government agencies and the government's taking care of them. But New Life Evangelist Center, they have to get their own funding, so people really need to help with donations. Things need to be repaired. There's a lot of people here. Sometimes charities volunteer to bring food and feed people, and they don't show up. And then New Life has to come in, and they've got to supply that food. So I believe you were looking for a goal of $50,000 or something just to work on those repairs. I think people should open their hearts, give you $100,000, $150,000, anything. You know, you don't have to wait till Christmas time to be to charity. Do it now. This center needs help. There's no other place for the people to go. You know, you can't just drive, you know, turn up your radio and drive down the street and let it be gone, because that person will still be homeless. They'll be there tomorrow. You've got to share your life.
Yeah. So while you've been here, you've been giving of yourself and helping out in different ways. What are some of the jobs that you've done here?
Oh, sure. I work at the free store. So the ladies come in, and their kids, like right now, they need coats. They don't have any coats. They need shoes. And and these women don't have the finances to do that. They're fighting to just even have food for their children.
Yeah.
So we offer the free store, and they can come in and get a nice little bag full of clothes for their kids and for their own self. You know, they got to go to work, and sometimes they can't afford the uniforms. So that's another place that needs donations, coats. Kids need coats and shoes.
Yeah. Well, thank you so much for sharing your story and really just kind of presenting the need. I just want to give people that opportunity. You can go to our website at newlifeevangelisticcenter.org. The shorthand of that is NLECSTL.org. You can write to us at P.O. Box 473, St. Louis, Missouri, 63166. But just remember that there are so many people right now, as it's, the weather starts to turn colder, who are not sure where they're going to go this evening. Literally, they don't have a place to go. And this is very real. And it's happening to, you know, our brothers and sisters, aunts and uncles, moms and dads. This is real. This is America. This is happening right now. And New Life is being there when people are hurting and in need. And so as you hear these testimonies, please go to those phones and call us, 314-436-2424 in St. Louis, 1-800-334-3276. Do your part so that we can continue to share the love of Jesus Christ with so many people.
Daily, I hear from individuals that have tried everywhere else and just aren't able to find help except at the New Life Evangelistic Center. Because of those of you that are praying and caring and sharing with New Life Evangelistic Center is stronger now than ever before. More new donors are coming in. More people are helping out. And at the same time, more and more people in need are coming. So many have tried calling the hotline, but the government-sanctioned shelters just don't have that place. Did you try calling that hotline, the homeless service hotline?
Yes.
And what happened?
Nothing.
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 Happened.
They're always busy. Call back. One time I was told to call back 3 months from the time I called. Well, what do I do in the meantime?
And so
I really have never even tried to be in another shelter. I've called the hotline a few times, but it's nice here. We're like a family. We're, you know, we just take care of each other.
You're asking everybody to pray October 21st. The Board of Public Service does not try to take away the hotel permit to this place?
Yes.
You're praying that we can continue to keep it open. Because what would happen to you and the 50 other people that are in training programs that live at 1411 Locust if it wasn't for this place? What would you do?
It's horrible. They don't have, they're hollering they're going to arrest us and stuff.
Who's hollering that?
The police. They're saying that they'll just start arresting us if we're out on the street.
They've told you that?
Mm-hmm.
They've told you that.
Yeah. And what are you going to do? It's, if you don't have a place to live, you can't just go up to someone's door and say, can I come stay with you?
There's a lot of people
I don't have family to stay with. And it's just, I don't understand. I don't understand the barricade still yet. And they've been up for a long time.
Yes, she's talking about the barricades around the facility at 1411 Locust Street. Fence they put around the park next door to keep the people out, but mm-hmm. those that have dogs can go in there with their dogs. The homeless often are treated worse than dogs. And they continue to come to New Life Evangelistic Center. Many are hurting, many are homeless. Let's go to Ray.
I'm talking now with Lewis. Lewis, mm-hmm. you're coming into our transitional program here. We're glad to have you here. Have you been homeless for quite some time or just a short time?
Short time.
Uh-huh. Can you tell us a little bit about yourself and how you came down here to New Life?
I'm from Chicago, actually. Come to visit my daughter. Uh-huh. Staying with her for a while. Me and a little boyfriend, we got into it. I decided, you know, be on my own. Mm-hmm. I had lost my job by then, so there's no need me actually staying there with him or her. Uh-huh. And that's how I ended up down here in Larry Rice's.
Yeah.
You know, I had nowhere else to go, because like I said, I'm from Chicago. So. Uh-huh.
Have you lived in St. Louis before, or is this the first time?
No, I'm from Chicago originally.
Really? You're
yeah.
from Chicago. So are you thinking about going back to Chicago, or you think you'll stay around here?
No, actually, once I get myself together, I'm going to Florida.
Florida?
Yeah.
Okay.
I have a son up there, an ex-wife, too. I've been keeping contact with them, and they've been trying to get me to come down there, but unfortunately, funds is kind of short, so I'm here for a minute.
Yeah, so this is kind of a stopping over point for you now. You're here for a while, and the thing is, wherever we find ourselves, we need to ask God, what are you teaching me in this chapter of my life? And try to find out what the Lord is showing you and be open to all that God has for you.
Well, he's been open to me pretty good. You know, I'm not starving, you know, I'm clothed good.
Uh-huh.
You know, I didn't have plenty of little jobs down here, so it's been pretty good.
You say you're seeking employment, or you have a job now?
No, I don't have a job now, but I had, you know, I worked at places. You know,
what kind of job would you like?
Really, it doesn't matter now. Anything would help, just, you know, try and get myself back together.
Uh-huh.
You know, I was doing shipping and receiving, you know, worked at Scott Trade, you know, setting up, you know, for the little events they had there.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, I tried everything. So, something's better than nothing.
Yeah. Have you found it's hard to get a job here?
It is, but not really, you know.
How does it compare to Chicago?
Oh, Chicago, I have no problem getting a job. It's bigger.
Oh, yeah.
You know, St. Louis is kind of small, and then it's hard to get around when you don't have the funds to get on, you know, go to the counties.
Mm-hmm.
You know. Mm-hmm.
Well, one of the benefits in the program here, we can give you some bus tickets to get around.
I heard about that too. Uh-huh. You know, I tried it several times, but like I said, majority of the time I've been working downtown, so it's been kind of close for me to go if I find a job. So,
yeah.
And other than that, like I said, the program, you know, just my first time here doing it, and I just need somewhere to actually, you know, rest my mind for a minute.
Mm-hmm.
You know, instead of being on the street constantly, just walking, wandering around.
Yeah.
You know.
Yeah. Well, that's that's important for people to understand that our program here gives people not only something to do, but something useful to do while you're here. You help out doing volunteer work, and then you can go out and look for a job and know that you have a place to come back to in the evening, or you know, after you've done your job hunting, come back here and get something to eat and have a place to live, keep the same bed, you know. So those are all some of the benefits of being in the transitional program.
Keep you nice and warm, you know.
Yeah. And so it's so vital that New Life Evangelistic Center be able to continue to offer these services to people. It's not just the shelter, and we're not warehousing people here,
right,
but we're trying to help people to break out of the cycle of homelessness. We always have done that, and we just try to improve the program over the years, that we have not only the two-year leadership program, but we also have the transitional program now that you're in, and we trust that this will help you to get some funds together. If it is the Lord's will for you to go on to Florida, that we know the Lord's going to make it possible.
Right. Mm-hmm.
And
like I said, I'm not mad about what's happening to me. You know, mm-hmm. It happens. I was doing good for a minute. Mm-hmm. Things just happened bad. Mm-hmm. I've been here 5.5 years.
Right.
So, just like I say, this is the first time. You know, I'm not saying I learned anything from being homeless, but mm-hmm. I know I don't like being homeless.
Mm-hmm.
I'm used to, you know, just sitting back, being able to watch TV, you know, cook my own meals, you know, instead of standing in the line waiting on food.
Mm-hmm. And you're used to working at a job, too.
Yes, I'm used to working, love to work. Mm-hmm. And unfortunately, a lot of medical conditions stop some of that, too. So,
mm-hmm.
you know, but it's cool. I can do part-time, but not too long.
Yeah, yeah. Well, God bless you. We wish you the best, and we trust that the time you're here will be a time that will benefit you as well as others.
I will, trust me. Thank you.
Thank you.
There are so many people coming to New Life that have nowhere to go. I'm talking to Barbara. Barbara, earlier you indicated the barricades and you indicated harassment that the homeless often get at the hands of the police out there.
Yes.
So you saw that. You know, what they're doing in Ferguson is that they're actually equipping the people with cameras to film the police. You think that's something that need to be done concerning the police and the way they respond to the homeless out there?
Yes.
That the police would, you know, they tell the homeless just about anything and everything. They've threatened you before, though, when you've just tried to sit down somewhere or when you tried to lay down somewhere?
Yeah, they don't want us around. If they could load all of us up and put us up in the Justice Center, they would. But they'd have to come up with a reason to have us there. Mm-hmm. And if you're not doing anything, what can they do?
So what do they say if you're not doing anything and you're just sitting there?
They just want to run names all the time, and you go on now. We don't need you standing around here.
You see the discrimination against the homeless.
Yes.
Did you always believe that took place before you became homeless?
No.
Did you know it was that bad?
No, I didn't know it was that bad. I didn't know homelessness was like it was, like it is now, that I'm in it. I never was scared of the homeless, because some of these people around here act like they're scared of us. I wasn't scared of homeless. I didn't think about them.
Are you aware of the parallels that exist between all that you hear going on in Ferguson and what's happening among the homeless? You have the racial profiling on the one side,
mm-hmm.
the homeless profiling on the other side, the discrimination, the apartheid. Now, the all-white board of public service is going to be making a decision, and many of whom are African-American. Yes, to help us understand some of these parallels and understand how important it is that you pray, support, and work to keep New Life Evangelistic Center open to all people, let's go to Bernie Hayes.
Hello, I'm Bernie Hayes. With me is Amy Hunter from the YWCA. Ms. Hunter, how are you?
I'm good. Thank you for having me on your show.
What's your position for the Y?
I'm the Director of Racial Justice for the YWCA, which means that I work on systemic and institutionalized racism for the YWCA.
Racism?
Yeah.
You work on institutionalized racism?
Yep.
Describe what that is. I mean, just give us a brief overview of what that means.
Sure. That means that we look at not just individual actions, but actual policies and procedures. So we look at things like what are your school suspension and expulsion rates? Mm-hmm. Is there an adverse impact on people of color, students of color? We look at things like racial profiling and mm-hmm. where does that occur and what can we do to make that end or eliminate that from our communities.
Okay. You know, for quite a few months now, a couple of years actually, Adolphus Pruitt of the NAACP has been in a fight, he and a few people from the county, about the racial profiling that was pervasive in Ladue.
Sure.
Black people driving home black, I guess I'll call it. But also, there's some racial profiling going on right here in the city of St. Louis, and also very close in proximity to the New Life Evangelistic Center. There's some people who own some condos across the street, actually, from New Life Evangelistic Center. And what they've done is filed a lawsuit to take away the hotel license from the New Life Evangelistic Center to house homeless people. Now, do you think racism is involved in that, or could that be considered part of profiling?
Yeah, you know what? I wish, you know, we could articulate racism as a sin, because it is, right? Sure. That when we are taking good care of each other as a community, that we care about everyone in our community, that our fictive kinship, if you will, so our connection to each other as brothers and sisters, as mothers and daughters, is that when we see a homeless person on the street, we offer, right? We figure out ways to take care of each other as if they were related to each other. And so I think what gets in the way sometimes is race, that we can't imagine our brother or sister being a person of another race. So in a biblical way, we say brother and sister, but also in a communal way. And so I cannot imagine kicking my brother and sister out of a homeless shelter that is designed to house the people that have no housing. Like, honestly, that goes against my own peace for humanity, my own connection to a higher power. And so I'm not sure what is motivating them, probably money, but I would ask for a moral imperative, for some moral and humane conversations to occur. And for us as a community to make sure that that never happens, because we are responsible for each other.
Plus, there's a lawsuit pending, and that's taking a real strain on the New Life Evangelic Center, on the program that they can administer, you know. Amy, you are a mother of African-American males, sons.
Yes.
And you've been involved in the Ferguson demonstrations or protests and so forth, or rallies. What inspired you to do so, and how do you feel as an African-American mother about the Mike Brown case?
Yeah, I think it goes directly to what I just said, in that Michael Brown could have been my child. I am really clear that violence and racial profiling in African-American boys happens across the country. And I don't want to hear another mother say what his mother said of, do you know how hard it was to get him to graduate from high school? I don't want to see another grieving mother of any color lose a child. And so that has really been what has motivated me to go down during the day and in the evening, is to prevent the sadness as a mother of anybody ever grieving the loss of a child again. And I hope that compels all of us to change it, right?
You were out there from day one when Michael Brown was killed. And Reverend Rice, as you know, had been jailed.
Yeah.
You know, he was part of the protest also. What motivated you to take part in these demonstrations, they call them? The press call them demonstrations and so forth and protests. What do you call it?
I call it taking responsibility for my community.
Sure.
And I think we as St. Louis will be even better. I want this to be a place where people want to come. And we have to make it that place. I want people from all over the country to say, you know what, if I could go anywhere to live, to educate my kids, where people are advocates for the homeless population. We have a homeless shelter at the YWCA too, for women. And we're better for it. And that taking care of each other has got to be where we end up in St. Louis. And that's something we can all be proud of. So figuring out ways that we can be proud of how we've contributed to making our city better, I think is what we should all go for. I think if you can't say what organization you're giving money to, this is a good organization to give money to. There are other organizations to give money to, but start somewhere and do something.
Mm-hmm. You also mentioned earlier when we were speaking about your faith, how your faith was anchoring you in this situation. Tell us about that.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. You know, I am really clear that God has been with me. From the first speech that I gave about my 12-year-old son being stopped by the police and me having to tell him that that was going to happen to him for the rest of his life, that God has been with me during the protest. God has been with me in having the conversations, staying focused on what's really important. I pray every day, all the time, for myself, for other people, for my children. And I think that this movement, if you didn't have faith beforehand, seeing people in this community come together in ways that we've never seen it happen, should be inspirational. And so having the conversation about Reverend Rice and this space should also be helpful for people who are trying to figure out what to do. Give.
Mm-hmm. We haven't talked about semantics that much, but you mentioned a word there, movement. Do you think this is a movement, Ms. Hunter?
I do think it's a movement. I think I think it's been mounting. Trayvon Martin certainly has been a conversation, but there are several names that we could list off to get people ready to shift. And I think people want to shift. I think, you know, across the racial lines, I think white people want this to be different. I think black people want this to be different. I think Latino brothers and sisters want this to be different, too. I think most people want this to be different. And so I think it will take a deep reflection of ourselves as individuals, but also as a community to make it different.
How should the community prepare itself for whatever happens with Darren Wilson, the officer who killed Mr. Brown? Should we be preparing for chaos? Should we be preparing for peace? How should we prepare ourselves either way?
You know, if you believe in faith, mm-hmm. then nothing happens by accident. And so the question we are asking ourselves is, in lieu of this, what do we do next? So regardless of how the Officer Wilson verdict comes out, really the question we're asking ourselves right now is, how do we make our community, our world, a better and safer place for everybody? And that doesn't have to wait on a verdict. We could be operating right now about making our space a better space to live in and breathe in. And for the people who don't want to protest to go down and rally, that's mm-hmm. that for everybody. Do something for an organization that is doing something for people. Certainly the New Life Evangelistic Center is one of those organizations. Of course, the YWCA is one of sure. those organizations. Mm-hmm. There's several. But do something like that. You'll feel better. You know what? It feels good to give. It feels good to know that you're contributing in a positive way. We're better as a city, but also individually, it just feels good. So do something. Do something.
What is the power of civil disobedience? Civil disobedience, I'm trying to say.
Yeah, what I've been most excited about with the young people is that they've got some practice with voice. Mm-hmm. And so I'm looking forward to them advocating for themselves, not just in the streets of Ferguson, but in schools, for policy for change. You know, for those of us who weren't there during the civil rights movement, probably the election of President Obama was a moment to notice how the country could come together for change and change in a really positive way. So I'm looking forward to the other positive changes that this brings. And there have been some great regional arts commissions doing stuff with artists, and Missouri History Museum's doing programs around healing communities. So there have already been some really good changes. We've got a long way to go and a lot more changes that can happen. So get plugged in to places that make sense for you and be part of the community, be part of the change.
Often we don't like to think about the difficulties that other people may be going through, whether it's the African-American community or the homeless community. But we find ourselves in situations like Barbara did, among the ranks of the homeless. And when it comes to being homeless, regardless of the color of your skin, you understand firsthand what it's like to have the bigoted and the prejudice direct such prejudice at you. And how does it make you feel when they tell you, you can't sit here and you can't sit there, and oh, you're homeless and we can't hire you?
It makes you mad because we all had jobs, we all had places to live. Everybody's got a different story. Not all of us are drug addicts. Not all of us are the biggest criminal in town. Not all of us are that way. We're just people that are down on our luck.
Well, you can imagine, though, if some, you know, you could change, if God willing, you'll find a place to stay and get a home of your own, and things go on as normal. But when you encounter this bigotry day after day because of the color of your skin, it gives you a little bit of an idea of what people have to live with, doesn't it?
Yes.
It's a very sinful, bigoted world. What can we do? Each one of us have to search our hearts. Each one of us has to be honest before God. Each one of us has to understand the culture that we grew up in and how this culture can influence us. We have to be honest with ourselves. And like Daniel in Daniel chapter 9, to repent. Repent for our ignorance. Repent for our indifference. Mm-hmm. Repent and ask God to have mercy upon us. So we as individuals, members of the community, of the people of God, we go before Him with hearts of repentance. And at the same time, we go with Him with prayers, asking Him to work through us that we might bring about change. As we pray, I like to think of the word ACTS. Spell it out, A-C-T-S, the A standing for adoration. You see this happening in Daniel chapter 9, where you just go before God and adore what a great and mighty God He is. And then the C stands for confession, where we ask Him to forgive us for our sins, our indifference, our feelings of hostility. The T, ask Him to forgive us for our sins. The T is thanksgiving for all that He has done. And the S is supplication, the asking. Please ask God now to meet the many needs we're facing here at the New Life Evangelistic Center. Please ask Him for victory, October 21st. And please ask Him to provide the much-needed resources so New Life Evangelistic Center can continue to be there when people are hurting.